Hello, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Jesse Duplantis.
And I'm Kathy Duplantis, and we're so excited about today's episode of the Boardroom Chat.
You call it an episode?
Why not? You know, when I was a little girl, I had a favorite toy.
You
little
did?
Bitty girl. You may not know this, but I had a little doll that was called the Chatty Kathy.
Oh, I know that now because I've been married to you 50 years, and you've been chatting ever since.
Well, when we first met, I wasn't very chatty, but lately you've been saying I've been getting pretty chatty.
You're getting pretty chatty.
Yes, I'm interrupting
you. A chatty Kathy.
Yeah, and the funny story about that is that the head came off one time, and my brother fixed it. This doll had like all these sayings. It would say you'd pull the string,
right.
And it said a lot of different sayings. And when my brother fixed it, put the head back on, he pulled the string to make sure it still worked, and it said, "I hurt myself." Isn't that funny?
That's funny. It's very funny.
But we're going to chat about a lot of great things today. We're
going to
get on the Word of God.
And actually, I didn't know what she was going to say. She doesn't know what I'm going to talk about. And it goes what I want to talk about today.
Oh, good. He never tells me.
Because I like shooting from the hip. What you think about is what you become.
Praise God.
And Kathy thinks about Chatty Kathy. What you think about is what you come. Do you know you have the ability to control your thoughts? Sometimes you have to lead your thoughts. See what I'm saying? Lead them to where you want them to go, or otherwise it's like a shotgun. It'll explode in every which way, shape, or form. And we got scripture for this. So, Kathy, I want to go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And I want to start reading with verse 3. And I want you to listen to me. Because what you think about is what you become. And that's so true. And, you know, a lot of people think that even when you sleep, you can still control your mind. If you put scripture in your mind before you go to bed. He said, "Lord, I want to think on good things." So Satan will come in and start injecting all kind of crazy stuff. And he will do that when you're asleep at times, you know, and things of that nature. So I want to read this here. Paul writing to the church at Corinth. Now, I'll start out with verse 3. He says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh." I want to stop there for a minute. That's a big statement.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody I know walks in the flesh. But Paul got to a point that his flesh didn't bother him. He didn't war after it no more. In other words, he quit fighting it because it was so dead.
Right.
Now, that's a miracle of the Lord Jesus Christ. And how that becomes is how you learn to control your thought process. Because what you think is what you become. Now, look what he says in verse 4. "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal." So we're in a warfare. "But mighty through God," not through you, "but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds." So there's strongholds all around us all the time. Constantly.
Right.
Watch this. Now, how do you do that? How do you get this stuff to work? The next verse, "casting down imagination." So notice this, they're not reality, they're just imaginations. See, "casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God." See, a lot of people don't understand that about healing. I am sick. I'm not dealing with you. I am sick. By his stripes you were healed. See, that sickness in your mind is exalted itself above what Jesus said. By his stripes you were healed. So people say, "Well, I am not going to say I'm healed when I am sick." They think they're lying. Not dealing with your am sick. I'm dealing with your were healed. If I can get you to look at your were healed, we get rid of your am sick. See, so anything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, what is the knowledge of God? The Word of God.
Right, the promises that
now,
are
everything,
in the Word.
And over 7,000 promises. Now watch this. He said, I want to read that again. "Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God and bringing into captivity every thought." Now people want God to do that. That's your job. Bringing into captivity. You got to captivate every thought, not to yourself, but to the obedience of Christ. So what I want to talk about there is thoughts. What you think about is what you become. See, you got to understand something. If you don't understand who you are, or if you don't know where you're going, you're not going to know when you get there. You know, I really say this, and I wrote a thought down. Thoughts unled is like a ship on a rough sea with no rudder. In other words, it doesn't know how to control itself. I mean, the wind's just pushing it, the waves throwing it everywhere. You got to have a rudder in life. And I personally believe the rudder is the Holy Ghost that lives inside of you.
Yes.
The Comforter. He says, "Howbeit, when the Spirit of truth has come, he will guide you in not some truth,
right,
but all truth." You understand what I'm saying? Now, the reason why I wanted to bring this up, have y'all noticed, maybe you have, but we live in the deep south. We call it Southeast Louisiana is how they say it. We've had more hurricanes and tropical storms this year. In fact, they were the same as 2005 when Hurricane Katrina hit. Okay. Now, watch this. We constantly getting bombarded, and I don't mean this to be critical. I'm just being truthful. With meteorologists saying this, saying that, saying this, and they don't really know what they're saying. There was a guy who everybody believed what he said when it came to the weather.
Years
and his
ago.
Name was Nash Robbins. Mm-hmm. And he would do it with a magic marker. He had no all this stuff that we have today.
No technology.
But
like
every time he said something, it happened. He'd study it. Now, they got all this stuff, satellites, everything. And they go, well, it's going to do this, and it don't.
Yeah, and even after they got all the satellites, I remember they did all their predictions and everything, and but everybody would still just say, well, what does Nash have to say?
What does Nash say?
And they'd bring him in, and he'd have his little clear board and the white and pencil, and he'd write it.
And he was right.
And he hit it on the target.
Why? Because he knew how to control his thoughts. And by him controlling his thoughts, he controlled our thoughts. He never put us in fear. You know, in any way, shape, or form. But now there are a lot of people, they say, you know, that thing, even though it's going west, but it could turn east, or it could do this, or it could do that. And before you know it, you got this flip-flopping going on all the time. I heard something last night just aggravated the socks off.
Oh.
You ready for this?
Yeah.
They knew that hurricane that's in the Caribbean that hit Cozumel, I believe it is, or that area, they knew it was not a Cat 4. Because the planes that walked around that thing, flew around it, but flying around that thing, and it could, the strongest wind they could come up with was like 107 miles an hour. Now, they said it had that thing at 140. Now, they dropped it down to 130. When it was not even near that, and they flew all over in the eye, out there and everything. Mm. You know, now why? What, and this was the excuse. Well, we know it's going to restrengthen. We don't want to flip-flop and forth. Well, wait a minute. You're causing fear that you shouldn't cause.
Well, Jesse, you know, that just thought about how, well, that's what's happening all over the world. Truth doesn't matter anymore.
No,
truth is what I say it is. That's what they claim.
Right.
But our truth is based on the Word of God and what reality is.
Yeah,
they can't just say something's a 3 when it's really not.
It's not.
But they just decided to make that their truth.
Yeah, and if Jesus is the way, you can't get lost. If he's the truth, and he is, you cannot be deceived.
And I was just thinking about your verse that you had. I want to read it in the Amplified. It's
sure.
Okay. It's in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. And it's so powerful because it says, inasmuch as we refute arguments. This tells us that the Holy Spirit convicts us, and it's our responsibility to get into be a part of the solution to the problem.
The solution, not the problem.
Solution to it.
Right.
It says, inasmuch as we refute arguments, theories, reasonings, and every proud and lofty thing that sets itself up against the true knowledge of God, and we lead every thought and purpose away captive into the obedience of Christ.
Hallelujah,
so we have
powerful.
A responsibility in this.
Amen.
To pull down those strongholds,
right.
You know, and take authority over those situations in our life that would want to keep us bound up, keep us in fear, keep us in torment, because the truth of God will always lead us in the right path.
Well, with that saying, that if your thoughts are to possess or to have true value, you have to learn to lead them.
That's good.
You see, you have to learn to lead them. And you learn to lead them. It said, like, if you get a bad, and I get a bad thought. Everybody gets bad thoughts. But when I immediately stop and say, no, that's not my thoughts. I open up the door and I lead that thought out of my mind. So you got to learn to lead your thoughts. That's not my thoughts. What are my thoughts? My thoughts are lovely, just, good report, pure, virtuous. The Bible said, think on these things.
That's
so if
right.
You're taking notes, I want you to write this down. If your thoughts are to possess true value, you must learn to lead them. If you don't, some other power may lead them.
Hmm.
You see, Satan, I want you to think on stuff you don't need to think about, because what you think about is what you become. I heard President Trump say something, I guess 3 years ago, and it was really, I thought, one of the best statements I've ever heard in my life. And he was talking about his daughter, Ivanka. He said, Ivanka, you're going to think anyway, so you might as well think big. And I thought, yeah, you're going to think anyway, so why not think the best instead of think the worst?
Right.
You
and I'd like
saying?
To take that another level and
okay.
Say, you're going to think anyway. Why don't you think God's thoughts?
Amen.
Why don't you think about what he has said you can do? Why don't you think about the promises that he has made you?
Both of me and you both do this all the time. When something tries to attach itself to our body, you know, we're human just like you are. We go, no, we take on God's thoughts. By his stripes, we were healed. Mm-hmm. We're not denying what we're feeling. We deny its right to exist in our lives.
Mm-hmm.
Now, don't complicate that. You see, you're trying to intellectualize that, and that's your problem. You can't
right.
intellectualize faith because it's above your intellectual activity. It is so powerful because it's so simple.
Mm-hmm.
See, and you're looking for something hard. I heard that great guy, E equals MC squared, wasn't he? Einstein.
He said,
you know, people think all this stuff, this knowledge. He said the hard things are the simple things because we're always looking, we're looking for something hard when really it's actually very simple, and we struggle. to try to get to it because we're trying to go this way, go, thinking that's got to be real hard, when really it is so simple. So let me read that point again, it'll help you. If your thoughts are to possess true value, you must learn to lead them. And if you don't, some other power may lead them. For example, they say you're walking down the street and some foxy mama will go by you. And she got a good figure and all, and you look at her, and ain't nothing wrong admiring the lady's beauty. She got a nice figure, that's fine. Now, if you let that begin to percolate, see, Satan said, let's lead that to something different.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? When you say, no. First, you're doing that person a disservice because she's more than body parts. I want to make an announcement. Parts wear out. You don't marry a woman's body or a man's body. They wear out. You understand? I love it. One time I went into this elderly folks' home, and there was this man, he was 98, and his wife was 96. And they were sitting there in their wheelchairs.
Yeah.
And you could see love like you ain't never seen. Now, you know, their bodies are gone. You can hang that up. But you know what? That love was stronger then it probably was when they first met, when they had, quote, everything intact. You see, so when you understand that, people say, why do we get divorces? Because we don't lead our thoughts. We let those thoughts lead us. For you know what? You start, bam, bam, bam. Mm-hmm. And you begin to get agitated, boom, boom, boom. Me and Kathy, we have a statement. We've probably said it before in one of the boardroom tracks. We never let the sun go down on our wrath. There's a scripture that says, do not let the sun go down on your wrath. In other words, you make it right.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Uh-huh. So when you understand that, I like to lead my thoughts. And that's why I do that at night. Sometimes the devil wants to put thoughts in my mind. I go, no, stop. Even when I'm sleeping, even when I'm dreaming, if I start to move and something, wait a minute. Stop. I still have control. A lot of people don't believe that. You still have control over your spirit. Your spirit's not sleeping. You see, your body is sleeping. Your spirit and soul is wide awake. You see what I'm saying? And going on with different kinds of things. So learn that with the word of God. And I like what Paul said. My weapons are not carnal. In other words, just don't try to find something physical to fix this
thing.
Right. Because it don't work that way. But they mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. My God, and there are strongholds in life. For example, strongholds will say this when it comes to money. Now, you better not give nothing to the church because, you know, you ever had too much month at the end of your money? What your money run out before the month does? And all of a sudden, maybe you got just a few dollars and the Lord begins to tug on your heart. Won't you be a blessing to that ministry? Won't you be a blessing to that? No, Lord Jesus. You know, I got to make it to the end of the month. No, you got to understand, you trying to make your life instead of God. Mm-hmm. You're not letting God lead you. Now, I'm not talking about doing stupid things. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is, if the Lord is telling you to do something, he's always right. Mm-hmm. He's the only person I know that's ever been totally 100% correct. Say what you want.
Right.
He was right. And, you know, people say, it's no way he could be the Son of God. Well, do you know anybody else in history that we talk so much about? Now, we got Caesar. You got them all. We all know. Think about this. Jesus is still stirring up the world. And it's been over 2,000 years. And he was a simple man from Nazareth. Isn't that amazing? Now, what made Jesus Jesus? He controlled his thoughts. How do I know that? He had temptations just as we have. Yet without sin. Why didn't he sin? He controlled his thoughts. He cast down that imagination. That thing that exalted itself against his father's knowledge, and he brought into captivity. And that means you got to grab it sometime because it's running, boy, into the obedience of the anointed one in his anointing.
Yeah, no, Jess, I was just thinking about how when Jesus walked with his disciples and he was starting to let them know that he was going to go to the cross. And I remember he told his disciples and he says that he was going to die on the cross, 3 days. What did Peter do?
Oh, he got mad.
He said he didn't like that thought that Jesus had. And he came and Jesus had to tell him, shake him basically, and say, get thee behind me, Satan.
How would you like your boss to call you a devil? You're a devil? Get thee behind me. That's exactly what he did.
Yeah.
Because he realized it wasn't Peter talking. See, Satan had led Peter's thought, and that was Satan talking through Peter. Principalities work through personalities. See, so in other words, Peter should have shut that down himself. So Jesus did it instead.
Mm-hmm.
You see, you got to understand something. Everybody has leisure time, especially leisure thoughts. Watch this. Write this down if you're taking notes. It's our leisure thoughts which ultimately determines our character.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, if you want to know who you are, it's what you think in a leisurely way. You see what I'm saying? Normally, if you're doing a job, your mind is so focused on that job, you ain't got anything else on your mind. You know, you got to get this job done. I got to do this or whatever. Mm-hmm. But it's when you're sitting here like this and all of a sudden you begin to realize who you are. And that's when it's time for you to lead your thoughts.
Right.
By casting down that imagination. Now, sometimes I get mad as a hornet at Kathy. Can you believe it?
No, I can't.
She can't, but I can. Praise the Lord. I have experience. She can make me madder than anybody in this world. But she also can make me happier than anybody in this world. Why? Because there's the spectrum there. You see, when we got married, God didn't change my personality, and he didn't change hers. What he changed was our spirits when we got born again. Mm-hmm. You see, in other words, our spirit became alive. So she's still her ugly self. I'm still my ugly self. Look at the women going, oh, I can't believe you
said that. Glad you said that second part.
Oh, I am. I was bringing myself into it. And I'm still my ugly self. All of us got ugly ways. Don't get mad at me. Control yourself. Everybody got their more ugly ways, you know. Like one time I told Kathy, I said, hey, Kathy, can you get me some water? She said, is your legs broke? I wasn't looking for a medical examination of whether my legs were broke.
Yeah, but picture this. We're both sitting down. It's different if I'm over there near the water or in the kitchen. We're both sitting down. So can you?
Yeah.
That's why.
I thought it was an excellent idea myself to just get a glass
because I had done it so often. You know, Jesse is, he doesn't think he's high maintenance, but he really
I am not
is.
High maintenance.
Yeah.
I'm very low maintenance. We've been arguing about that for 50 years. I just want you to know
but,
that.
But, you know, early in...
See, it's the leisure thoughts.
The leisure thoughts. Well, it was all because, you know, when you first started traveling in the ministry, Jody and I would wait on you hand and foot when you came back.
And what was wrong with that?
We were just so glad for you to get home. That you said you were thirsty. Oh, we'll get you that water. Or we'll do this. And we'll take your shoes off. Whatever.
Oh, it's
whatever
great.
We could
I
do.
Loved
just
it.
So glad you were home. But then when I started traveling, too, and we both were gone, and Jody was not in the house, and so it's... You know, you still expected that same treatment, so you stepped in.
Well, yes. Hallelujah. I mean, you like what you like, don't
you?
And
so he says, when I tell him he's high maintenance, he says, no, I'm not. I said, yes, you are. He says, well, I'll eat just about anything that you give me, and that's really true.
That's true?
Yeah. Yeah, it's like
because you don't cook very much.
Food groups, whatever.
You've got to grab what you can.
Two restaurants. Anyway, so I'll tell him, yeah, you'll eat just about anything, but I have to get it to your mouth.
That's true. So, like, see, we had this argument when I'm home every Sunday. Could we go out and eat? You don't have to church something. You're going to relate to this. I look at her, I said, where you want to eat? She goes, I don't know. Well, what do you want to eat? I said, well, no, pick whatever you want. See, Kathy's way pickier about food than I am.
That's because when you say pick, all he really means is pick out of the three that I really always want to go.
Because, see,
to.
I've traveled most of my adult life. Let me interrupt her. I travel my most adult life. She does it. So you got to grab what you can get when you're on the road. She don't understand that, never will. But that's all right. That's another day. That's another message. My wife said, I'll say, where do you want to eat? She goes, I don't know. Whatever you pick it. No, I want to know where you want to eat. No, you pick it. I said, okay. I drive up to the restaurant. I said, how about that? I don't want to eat here. Yeah, but you just said I could pick it. And then we start over. Okay, back out the restaurant's parking lot. Where you want to eat? Where you want? And we go back and forth. And then I said, we get in. It still works. Get in. We sit down and we order something. She gets mad because I eat the same thing. She said, why don't you try something different? I don't want to. Why? Because I like with that. So when I'm trying something different, I said, well, try something different. So she tries something different. And she decides that she don't like it. So she starts looking at my food. I said, what you looking at my food for? Well, can I have yours? No, you can't buy it. Because you tried something different. Why don't you try what you eat?
Well, it happens for
do
me,
do you
too.
Understand? It's frustrating.
It happens for me, too. I'll order something, and I call him the seagull because I never know when he's going to swoop in and grab something.
Oh, yeah, I take
plate.
A taste of it. Yeah.
He just does it without even asking.
Well, no, I paid for it.
But, you know, a minute ago, you said we have an argument. But, you know, I grew up in a household with a lot of loud arguments. So
yes.
What we have, you might call it an argument. I call it a discussion. As we're talking about it, I mean, I know about people who really have physical fights and arguments. And we're not talking about that when we talk about how we're just discussing. And we usually come to an agreement. And
oh, we always do. Yeah, that's not the issue. You know, I mean, we don't just go and say we ain't eating. It's just starve. We don't do that kind of craziness.
You know what? I think that's healthy. If you see a relationship where you have a husband and a wife where the wife says nothing all the time and
something
she's
wrong.
Quiet, then that means he's too controlling.
Very
you ought
controlling.
To be able to discuss and talk.
Now you want you to tell me, I don't control you, do I?
You try.
Well, yeah, I'll try. Hey, I didn't say I didn't try. I said
I can. I try to control you, too. I'll say, please, don't throw those dirty socks on the floor, please. Or, you know, we have this one little argument. I've stopped arguing. You must remember, I have stopped arguing because he would grab a fork, eat something out of the refrigerator, and put that fork right there on the countertop. And I'd say, can you at least bring the fork over to the kitchen sink? You don't have to wash it. You don't have to even put it in the dishwasher. But please don't leave it on the counter. That's filthy.
But tell him how you get mad at me about my chocolate cake.
Listen to this. He loved to just go get his fork and put it. Are we just telling all our nasty?
Let's tell all our nasty.
And so he would just go and eat off the cake, just bite off a piece with my fork. In that beautiful layered cake.
And she just goes nuts.
And I said, why do that? I said, because if someone comes over, I don't want to cut a piece with your fork print in there.
Well, cut that piece out and give them a slice.
So there was a day. Can I tell you a story? There was a day where we were both dieting. We hadn't had sugar maybe 6 months. We go on these phases where we get thin, then we get fat, then we get thin. Anyway, we had been dieting for like 6 months.
You notice we're a little thinner this time.
Right now. Don't write it in stone because it could change. Anyway, we were watching this movie and a commercial came. We was watching an old movie on a Saturday afternoon or something. We weren't traveling. And then the commercial came on. It was like a Duncan Hines or Betty Crocker. One of those yellow cake, which is our favorite, yellow cake. Chocolate icing, and they were just whipping it up. They iced it.
They did the fork like that, and they pulled out, and icing went.
Yeah, the icing was whipped up. It was really delicious, and I was staring at it, and he's staring
I'm
at
staring
it.
Like this.
And then he turns around and looks at me, and I said, do you want me to make you one of those? And he said, yes.
She said, you want me? I said, yeah.
So I got in the car right away, squeezed out of the driveway.
She burned rubber. She laid rubber down, man.
Within an hour, because I didn't have all those ingredients in the house. Of course, when you're dieting, you don't want all the sweet stuff. You don't want any temptation.
Don't bring your own temptation to your house.
Anyway, so I made the cake, and I remember thinking, you know, I don't want to get on his case. I'm always telling him, don't put your fork in the cake. So I said, I'm going to do it this way. I'm going to cut it in half so that he can have his cake. I said, Jesse, mutilate it. Eat it any kind of way you want. This is my half. I meant my half.
Whoa.
That I would have in case people would drop by and be able to share it, you know, give a piece of cake to a guest. But instead what happened is I ate all of that half.
No, you got some milk. I like
Well, I gave you your half and I ate my half.
Right. She gave me a quarter of milk and I just didn't even put it in a glass. I had it there with my half a cake. She had her milk and we started eating this stuff.
And we ate it all.
We
ate it all.
And about 20 minutes after the last bite, maybe 10 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
I had chocolate all over my way. I said, Kathy, we have sinned. A great sin.
We did it together.
We are gluttons. We just could. And all of a sudden, we paid the price. She took off running to the back. I took off running to the side.
You didn't have to tell that part.
Well, we paid the price. What you sow is what you reap.
So now, whenever I get that thought about making that cake and doing that, I cast that baby down.
Yeah, cast that.
We're not going to do that again. We learned.
And we learned. We have never done that since.
Yeah.
You know, because we paid the price. Let me just say we paid the price. But you know what we could have done? We didn't have to do. We could eat all the cake we want to eat.
Right.
Just don't have to eat it all at one time.
One small piece.
But we just wanted that sugar.
Well, you still just had one piece.
but that was a half a cake. Good Lord Jesus.
Instead of a saucer, it was on a plate.
Yeah, I mean, it was amazing. But we paid the price for it, I tell you what. And the Lord didn't rebuke us or anything. I realized, I said, good God, we stopped one bite from sin. That's called gluttony, man. I mean, you know, of course, your body can't handle all that kind of, I guess, that rush of sugar, sweet, whatever it was.
Especially when you hadn't had sugar in like 6 months.
Yeah, you know. But we didn't cast down that imagination. When we saw that, with that icing, with that thing, it just kind of, Lord Jesus, you know. So they say never go to a grocery store when you're hungry because you're going to spend a fortune, you know, that kind of stuff like that. And we even believed this one time. We would go eat pizza, and we'd eat just the top. But we each get a larger piece and eat the whole top. You know, we died.
I don't remember getting the larger piece.
Oh, Kathy.
I forgot that
place in Honolulu there. What's the name of that little, we love that little pizza place.
I
can't think of the name. And we think, we're going down there, of course we left all the dough, you know, everywhere. But do you know how much calorie was in the top of that thing? Good God. But that's how dumb y'all, because see, we didn't cast down that image. We don't do that no more. You know, we use some sense. This is many, many, many years ago. Now, I'm making this funny, but let's just face it. Sometimes your thoughts get you in major trouble.
Right.
And sometimes you don't know how to get out of it, which brings me to this thought. I want you to write this down. We as people have two selves, the life we live in the sight of men and the life only God and ourselves know of. I mean, do you live by yourself like you do live out in public? Mm-hmm. You should be. You should be the same at home
right.
as you are when you're in public. And I'm going to have to say this. I don't mean this. I'm not being arrogant. I am the same at home as I am in the pulpit. Am I correct? People
That's
have said
true.
That. I don't flip-flop. But a lot of people like to show you one side of them, and then when they're by themselves somewhere, they want to show another side, which I think is a disservice to yourself. Because that other person is going to show up every once in a while when you least expect it, see?
Right.
And it might embarrass you, and maybe it won't. Maybe it'll help you, bless you. What I loved about Jesus was the same when he was just with his disciples as he was when he was with the multitude. Mm-hmm. And you know why? Because Jesus is the same
yesterday,
today,
and forever.
What I wanted to major on was the word same. Mm-hmm. And Jesus is the same. In other words, Jesus is Jesus, and that's it. Mm-hmm. Well, Jesse is Jesse. And that's it. Not that I'm better or greater. I'm just who I am. I wish I could be other people. There's some great people I admire. I wish I could do what they do, but I can't. So I do what I can do. Mm-hmm. Now, I do that by controlling my thoughts. That's why I don't walk in jealousy. That's why I don't walk in envy. Because that's a big problem in the human race. Well,
right.
If they can do it, I can do it. They're not doing it because they want to do it. They want to do it because somebody else happened to do it. I'll just show them I can do it better, which is a wrong way of thinking. You see, you need to cast down that thought. That's why Paul said, I war not after the flesh. Paul was pretty blunt-minded. He'd say things that just knock your socks. Peter was very blunt. And sometimes you need to be blunt. You know what I'm saying? Don't misunderstand me. Sometimes you do. But what I'm saying is when you understand it, and when it becomes in a rude sense, then that thought needs to be brought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Because words are vessels. They carry
right.
things with them.
That's true.
You know what I'm saying? And you don't realize, like Kathy sometimes, and I say this, and I never thought how she thought until the other day. This happened about a week ago. You know, we've been on these diets, like losing this weight, you know, all that kind of stuff. So we thought, and Kathy's lost some weight. People say we were at the glorious woman's thing. And they said, boy, Miss Kathy lost some weight. Boy, you lost some weight. I said, well, thank you. I said, you know, when I married Kathy, she was 95 pounds. Now, what I was saying was, that was the truth. But what Kathy thought of, oh, so I'm a big hog now? You know, I'm a big fat person. 50 years. That never crossed my mind.
Tell him,
she needs to bring into captivity that thought.
I'm trying to teach it. Right now, what I always tell them is my weight is not your subject. Talk about you.
What's that? What did Bill Johnson say with that joke?
Oh, I think, my daughter has a towel that says it too in the kitchen.
Okay.
She had said, and there's a scientific fact that men that point out a woman's weight gain, I think it's something like that, don't live as long as the women. How does it say? Something
I have
like
no
that.
Idea.
Men who
no,
point
don't
out,
mess with it.
Men who point out a women's weight gain don't live as long as the women.
I don't know.
I'm mixing it up.
Yeah, by the towel.
Don't point it out.
Don't point it out.
You're not going to live as long as her.
I don't see to me.
Oh, they live longer. Okay, men. Women who gain weight live longer than the men who point it out or something like that.
First thing first, now I'm going to say something. Don't get mad when I say, if you fat, I don't care. That ain't none of my business.
You're
if
right.
you like you, I like you. I mean, hey, I got no problem with that. If you skinny and you like you, I like you. And if I see some of these bodybuilders, men and women, that just, I mean, they got the perfect, what do they call it, perfect body, hard body, whatever. I don't get mad. If they like them, people say, well, I don't think that's just ego. No, maybe that's what they want to do. You see, that's that envy. That's that jealousy that thought needs to be captive to the obedience of Christ. You see what I'm saying? It's just that simple. But that causes so much trouble in life, you see, because you must be superior to that power instead of driven by it. Mm-hmm. You know, I've learned that. There's some things I can do. People say, why don't you get involved politically with some things? Well, because God called me to preach the gospel. And I'm an avid vote. Me and you, we vote in local, state, and federal elections all the time. I believe in that. Because if you don't vote, then my God, man, then don't say nothing about anybody. Because you didn't use with your tool to change it. It's that simple. So, but God called me to preach the gospel.
We're not afraid to speak up what we believe.
No.
I believe in voting the Bible.
Amen.
And I don't mind telling, I'm probably more political than you.
Yeah. Kathy's a little bit more political than I am. And what I mean, I vote the scripture. Mm-hmm. I mean, how can you really separate that? I know people say you can. I don't disagree with him. I have to think more about that. You know what I'm trying to say? So when you understand things that happen, you know, sometimes there's not an answer. But the Bible said, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of who?
God.
Not the scientists.
Mm-hmm. Not
let him ask of God. Now, how you ask of God? You go to his word.
That's right.
You find out what he says about these things. And when you understand that, God's word works for you, not some of the time, but all the time. Well, Brother Jesse, how do I captivate these thoughts? Write this down. To lead your thoughts, you must use repetition. Mm. In other words, you know where to go, but if you let it just angle off and go this way and go that way, it's going to bring you in a place you didn't want to go. You see? And sometimes, you know, when you don't investigate something, you really don't know the why people do what they do. See, sometimes people do things that I don't know why they did that. It's not valid to me, but it's very valid to them. Why? Because maybe they researched it. I don't know, you know? You know, it's kind of like Kathy, she said, why don't you like that? I don't know. I just don't. And then I'll ask her, why don't you like that? Well, I don't know. I just don't. Why? We're one being in Christ, but we're two separate entities also, see, in terms of personality and likes and things of that nature. So I don't have a problem with her pastoring a church. Well, she's a woman. I know that. I didn't marry a man. I married a woman. Don't get mad at me. Don't send me no ugly letter now because I'm going to throw it in the trash. You understand what I'm saying? What happened was I think she can preach just as well as I can, maybe better. She's got just as good of thoughts.
I wouldn't say that.
I mean, look, I don't mind receiving instruction from a woman. I don't mind having a woman boss. Now, some men can't handle that kind of stuff. That's ego. That's jealousy. That's envy, simply because she's a woman. They got some very smart women, got some very smart men. Mm-hmm. And right now, years ago, they used to call it a man's world. It's no longer a man's world anymore. I mean, you think about it, some of the greatest companies we have today are the CEOs of women. Why? Because they do the job. I would think that in my ministry here, I have a lot of women in high authority. I mean, you understand? Why? Because they can do the job. Just that simple. We have no color here. We have no gender here in terms of male or female, whatever. Can you do the job yet?
Mm-hmm.
Do the job. It's just literally that simple. You see what I'm saying? So when you understand, you lead your thoughts by repetition. So if I'm feeling, if I'm getting scratchy or cold trying to grab me, I lead that thought to by his stripes, you are healed. Mm-hmm. Then after I'm all, and I got rid of it, not scratchy anymore, then I lead my thought to divine health.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not getting sick anymore. Now, if you want to make the church world mad, just say that. Oh, who do you think you are? See, that's that jealousy. That's that. You mean to tell me you can't live? You see, they're already making a decision about you by how they would do it when they didn't give you a chance for you to do what you know to do.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's something higher than divine health. That's called divine life. Divine healing, divine health, divine life. You know, Kathy, many years ago, everybody used to preach that. You don't hear that much anymore. And I noticed a lot of people have been getting sick. They used to never get sick.
Mm-hmm.
But every time when they didn't get sick, they got criticized for not getting sick.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember when Hurricane Katrina came? You know what me and Kathy did? You can call it stupid, but we were being led by the Spirit of God. We laid hands on all these buildings. I went and laid hands on my trees. I like my trees. And I said, I don't want anything broken. And some preacher in New Orleans said, oh, you're probably not going to have any damage at all. You want them word of faith, guys. No. I said, well, I agree with that. Why would it be mad at me? Well, you know what? And I'm not being prideful in any way, shape. Their places were destroyed, and we didn't have nothing destroyed. Not a thing. We had one little wall that went down because you didn't want the thing.
It was a decorative.
Cass said, I hate that thing, and I happen to like it. Well, the Lord heard, honey, the wind knocked that little piece. That wouldn't. I mean, you could pick it up with your hand. That's how simple it was. My point is this. He was mad, watch this, because we didn't have any damage. He should have been glad. Because what happens, because we didn't have damage, we were able to bless people and help people.
Mm-hmm.
Well, why don't you do this? People get mad. Now, oh, I'm going to make somebody real mad now. You know, that church down there is giving away food. Good. Why don't you give away food? Because the Lord didn't tell me that. Now, does that bother you? It can bother you all day long. Because I'm going to do what God tells me to do. But you have no idea how much food I bought. I don't tell you what I do. Why? Because I need no recognition for that. I do that as unto the Lord. See, everybody has their gift.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they're called to do. You see what I'm saying? And we bless and we minister, man, when we have tragedies. You have no idea what we do. I'm thinking about one person that came up to me the other day, and he said, "Whew, what you sent, what you did for, oh, you don't realize what you did?" I said, "Oh, yes, I do. Yes." And it wasn't the magnitude or anything. I just obeyed God. It was God. All I did was obey. Mm-hmm. But I may do something that another church won't do. You see what I'm saying? And that's fine, because everyone's called to those different kinds of gifts.
Everybody does their part.
Yeah, you do your part. One body made up of many members, it's the same way, you know what I'm saying? Now, I am a churchgoer. All this COVID thing, people say, "I'm not going to church." Man, God, you mean to tell me you're going to let fear, which you should not have, stop you? Now, you need to protect yourself. I tell people, you want to wear a mask? Wear a mask. Wash your hands. I'm not against any of that kind of stuff. But I will not allow the devil to stop me when God says, forsake not the assembling of yourself. So some of y'all need to get out of that house and go back to your house of worship. Mm-hmm. You know why you're not doing it? Your thought is controlling you instead of you controlling your thought. Mm-hmm. Do you see my point? Which brings me to this, and you'll understand what I'm talking about. Think good until good thinking becomes a habit.
That's good.
Make your thoughts interesting. See, you think good.
It does have to become a habit.
Good thinking becomes a habit. Mm-hmm. People say, how come you don't have any financial stress? Well, I'm a giving addict. I'm literally an addict. Mm-hmm. And guess what?
Say, God supports our habit.
And God supports our habit. We've made giving a habit. And let me say my point again. Think good until good thinking becomes a habit. Make your thought interesting. And also, I'll expand my thought. I say, "Lord, let me expand that thought. Be ye therefore doers. I'm going to do this thing." And he says, "Okay." It's the same thing. You know, when God tells us to do something, if you sit back and say, "Well, let me, I don't know if I," and you know the voice of God, you're going to allow doubt and fear and confusion to come in there. And before you know it, your thoughts are leading you instead of you leading your thoughts.
Yeah.
So that's what Paul is talking about in this passage. Mm-hmm. "For our weapons are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ." You see, you've got testimonies here. Mm-hmm. Somebody sat down and wrote their thoughts. Mm-hmm. Read some, Kathy. Now, this is their thoughts.
Okay, let's see. This one I saw earlier from Francisco. It says,
San Francisco?
No. The name of the person is called Francisco.
Oh, Francisco. Okay.
Says, "I really love your teaching. It really has blessed me for a long time. I am from San Jose, Costa Rica, Central America. I enjoyed this teaching today. All." I think it's a past
talking
one.
About all, says, yes.
"May God bless you big." I love that one. This other one is from Australia.
Okay, that person took control of their thoughts and wrote it down.
That's right.
That's what I'm saying.
Right.
Go ahead, Catherine, next one.
Oh, I didn't know if you wanted to meet a few of this different nations that are writing.
Yeah, that's great.
"I live in Australia. I'm a partner there. Mm-hmm. I just love you too. Thank you for all that you do." Isn't that awesome?
Can I say thank you for being a partner? I don't mean to interrupt. Mm-hmm. I mean, partnership is what keeps this ministry functioning. Why don't God just drain the money out the sky? Let me tell you. He'd be a counterfeiter. God uses men. He causes men or causes people to give into your bosom. Now, you don't abuse that. Some ministries have abused that. The medical world has abused some of your money. I mean, the other day I went and had a procedure. And watch this. The first thing the people told me was, "Make sure you have your insurance card." I said, "Let me tell you something, lady. I don't need the insurance card. I got insurance. But my God, I can buy this building."
I got the same thing that happened to me. I had to get a tooth pulled.
Yeah.
And the fork, they would even pull the tooth. They had to bring my purse in because you had it with you in the lobby.
Oh, yeah. What the,
and I
what
had
the
to give them my Discover card so that they could charge me before they pulled the tooth.
Yeah. And I don't have a problem with them making money. The lady didn't know what to say to me. I said, "Let me tell you something, sweetheart. I don't need health insurance. I can pay this all day. I can buy this building."
But it was,
and she just looked at me like, "What?"
The way it was done was different.
They've let money lead them. See what I'm saying? And it became wrong. It was wrong way of thinking. Mm-hmm. And she said, "Oh, I apologize." I said, "I'm not asking you to apologize. What I'm saying is, see, you've got so used to saying that."
There must have been a lot of people that didn't pay their bill.
And that's true. And they got to make a living. They got to pay their lease, I guess, or whatever. I understand all that. But you see, that's what I'm saying. You should lead your thoughts instead of your thoughts leading you.
Right.
Read another one of those great testimonies.
Okay, this one, a few of them we have. This Alex says, watching from Ethiopia.
Ethiopia.
Yeah. And then this one, where was it?
What did he say? What did he say?
That's
from
it,
Ethiopia?
Just watching from Ethiopia.
Thank you for watching from Ethiopia. Glory to God.
Yeah. And this one that says, from Mitzi, it says, I'm so thankful to see you on my news feed. I love to see you both preaching and serving together.
Isn't that a blessing of the Lord? That's great. I got to go back to Ethiopia. Hey, do you know you're in the Bible? There was an Ethiopian. God took a man out of a revival and put him there to talk to the Ethiopian.
Right, right.
Why? Very important in life.
Right.
Every nation is very important. Every person is very important because we're God, all God's creation. Mm-hmm. See, now, if you think evolution, then evolution says, well, you're not quite as important as this. So I'm going to evolve this boy better or this woman better. That's wrong. God created mankind.
Right.
Or he created the human race. There's only one race, the human race. You see, so I appreciate all that. And the lady talking about the partnership. You know, I mean, people have been having some struggles in their finances. And yet they faithfully support this ministry.
Right.
And you know what? We faithfully take what they give and put it into world evangelism. You see what I'm saying? And God just does wonderful things. And I tell people this all the time. The anointing of increase is on this ministry greatly. It's called a hundredfold anointing. The anointing of increase is on me personally. The other day, I'm going to say this.
Okay.
I went to Virginia. I had a wonderful time because it was starting to travel. And it was the pastor, it was their 35th wedding anniversary, I believe. And their 30th anniversary of pastoring the church. Mm-hmm. They were so kind to me, very kind to me. So they said, receive your own offering. We've placed all your offering envelopes, the people have them. I said, okay. But what they did not understand on the way coming over there, flying over, the Lord said, I want you to do something unique for these people. I thought, okay. So when I got there, you know, I did it and everything. I thought it was time to receive the offering. Now, it cost me a lot of money to fly there, all that kind of stuff. I never charge churches when I go.
That's right.
I don't give them their expenses. I pay my own. And there's nothing wrong with paying people's expenses. Hey, you know, you want to buy their food, you want to buy their airplane ticket, you want to take care of their hotel. I think they're a guest. You should do that. I don't. I pay for everything myself. Now watch this. So when it came time for the offering, I said, ushers, stand to your feet. So people started reaching for the offering. I said, I want you to pass your offering envelope to the right with nothing in it. Everybody did this. I said, do that. Nothing in it. Don't put nothing in it. Nothing in there. Nothing. Okay? Pass it to the right. So they got all my empty envelopes. Mm-hmm. I said, now take those and bring it to one of my employees. That was Roy. Mm-hmm. I said, I want two buckets. Now I saw it in their mind. Oh. I guess you don't want people touching that because the COVID, stuff like that. They're going to put a bucket here and a bucket there. I said, give me two buckets. I brought two buckets. Now, the pastor and his wife, I want to say their name. I don't guess they would mind, but I'll just keep it private. Mm-hmm. Wonderful people. I took the bucket. I said, now put one bucket in front of her and one bucket in front of him. Now, the pastor looking at, I was up on a platform. They didn't know what to do. What's going on? And I went off the platform. I said, the offering tonight, I wanted to give this to this pastor and his wife. This is their 35th anniversary of marriage and 30 years past. I said, now, I'm not asking you to do something that I won't do. I didn't know how much money I had on me. So I reached in my pocket. I still carry cash. I'm kind of old fashioned like that. And I had $550. I threw it in a bucket. I said, come on. I want everybody. Everybody began, I said, give them. You don't have to give as much as me. You can give more than me. I don't know. And boy, I mean, they didn't know what to do. What happened? The Lord wanted to bless them. I could have said, now, I tell you what, cost me thousands of dollars to come to Virginia. I had to go there, do that. And, you know, but I said, no, I lead my thoughts to be a blessing. And you know what the pastor and his wife said? This has never happened to us, ever. It was such a blessing. Now, why did I do that? Why? I listened to the thought that God placed in my mind, and I led that thought to obedience.
Right.
Instead of saying, well, I could have used it over here.
Instead of arguing with that thought, once you knew it was the Lord.
But here's the miracle.
And it's okay to check, because you do that too. Lord, is this you? You pray about it.
Yeah.
And you feel the leading, you know.
So watch this.
God guides us.
And I told the people, I said, God going to bless me like you ain't never seen. And God will bless you. I'm in the car. They're bringing me back to the airport. Okay. I have my own plane. Does that make you mad? I'm sorry. but I ain't getting rid of it. That's just the way it is. I'm very blunt. You're going to never misunderstand Jessica Plants. And before I got on the plane, before I left that place, a person gave me almost the same amount of money that I had put in a bucket. I hadn't even, I said, it's going to happen. Jesus. And I could just see it happening. And since then, the money had been flowing. Why? Well, the anointing of increase. Now, I heard someone in the spirit just say, well, I'm going to try that. Don't try that because you're going to go broke.
It's spirit-led giving.
Yes, right? It's spirit-led.
You know, we've been talking today about casting those imaginations. Yes. It's really training your human spirit to listen to God and to obey God, right?
Yeah, that brings me to this point. St. Paul used the word captivity. Why? It's a military word. Your thoughts are everything to you and man. In other words, you take command over that.
Right.
And when you understand that, God's word will work. So if you're physically sick right now, you take command over that disease. You need some. Maybe you open up your wallet and you got an abundance of lack. Ain't nothing in there, you know, just space.
Yeah.
You need to take command over that. And the best way to do that is sowing seed. Mm-hmm. Well, how are you going to sow seed for healing? I'm not talking about money. You don't pay for healing. Jesus already paid that. By his stripes you were healed. But what happens is everything deals with the seed. That's why I pray for healing. Because when I lay hands on people or when I pray for healing, and I'm going to pray for that in just a minute, guess what I get? I get a harvest off it. I get health. Okay, when I sow money seed, guess what I get? Money. If I plant an apple tree, guess what's going to happen? I'm going to get apples. The seed reproduces after its kind. So let me just say this. You're having financial trouble? Sow a seed today. Mm-hmm. You asked? Why you haven't? So said, but I don't have much. It don't take much. What is this huge oak tree that was once an acorn this big that held its ground? You see what I'm saying? That's what I'm talking about. See, as long as the earth remains, seed time, harvest time. So I want to thank all my partners for allowing us to do it. For giving, many of you give now, and I feel led of the Lord to say that. And I normally I don't do that, but I feel led of the Lord. Some of you need to do something. Why? So you can expand. That's how it works. You see what I'm saying? And it works in the physical, it works in the spiritual, it works in the natural. Okay, you see, I got a bunch of people behind me here. You know why I'm standing here, sitting here today? Mom and daddy sowed some seed. And I'm the harvest of that. Works physical. You can say, you can say till you've dropped dead, I want a baby, but if you don't sow no seed, it ain't happening. Now don't freak out over that. That's called nature. That's common sense. So you need some finance, sow a seed. You can give online, you can go to JDM.org and give, you can use PayPal, you do whatever you want to do. If you don't feel led, hey, don't do it. Now, I feel led to pray for healing.
Okay.
People need some healing in their body. Mm-hmm. So, this sounds stupid. Put your hands like this. And we're going to believe by faith.
Thank you, Father.
And I'm going to sow this healing because I am feeling good today. And I'm going to get even healthier. And you're going to get healing. And then when you get your healing, you go pray for somebody else that's sick. And they're going to get some healing. And before you know it, you start developing health. And then from that, you start developing life. Father, in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Father.
I come against cancer, diabetes, high blood pressure, crippling arthritis, infectious disorder of any kind. Satan, I get great pleasure in telling you, get under these people's feet.
Thank you, Father.
I come against that COVID virus. I bind it in Jesus' name. I come against cancer cells. I come against heart trouble, whatever.
Thank you, Lord.
I defy the devil to try to stop this because he can't. Because Jesus, by his stripes, they are healed.
Amen.
You said the two of them agree.
Thank you, Father.
Lord, I'm agreeing with them.
Thank
I'm going to be
Lord.
There too. Me and Kathy, we two, we're going to be there too, right there. We thank you for healing people that need it now.
Thank you,
Lord, I ask you to bless people that are giving today
Father.
Like you've blessed me.
Thank you.
Lord, I couldn't even get out of town and you blessed me.
Thank you,
Father. And you still blessed me. I want you to bless them financially.
Thank you, Lord.
But what did I do? I sowed the seed. But I knew a harvest would come. So thank you, Father, for our partners who bless this ministry. I thank you for it. I believe you for it. I call it done in Jesus' name. What you think is what you become. I hope you enjoyed it today. And Kathy, did you enjoy it?
I totally enjoyed it.
Do you have anything else to say before we
go
on?
I do, and I didn't want to interrupt in case that was it. But, you know, you talked about casting down imaginations.
Yes. How
the weapons of our warfare are mighty through God.
Or not calm, mighty through God.
I just want to let you know the main weapon that you have is the Word of God. Bible calls it the sword of the Spirit, and it's packed full of instructions and wisdom and examples of how when you believe God's Word, then you will be victorious.
And you know, Kathy, most people think it's in your hand. It's not. It's in your mouth.
It's the sword of the Spirit. In fact, you can read about it in Ephesians chapter 6. It talks about take on the whole armor of God, stand in the strength of God.
Amen.
And one of the parts of the armor, we're not going to go into, that's a long teaching that we maybe can save for another day.
Let's do that next week
next
on that
week.
Whole armor
okay,
of God.
Okay, great, because I was looking at that, and it really flows in with this really well.
Okay.
Because it talks about take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God.
Hallelujah. It's in your mouth. Now watch this. It's called the helmet.
It's a weapon.
I'm going to lead you into the next week. The helmet of salvation. It ain't the cap. It's the helmet. In other words, your face is covered. Satan don't know it's you. He think you God because you got God's clothes on. But that's for next week.
It's going to be good.
Oh, it's going to be good. Until next time, this is Jesse and Catherine Plains said, thank you for viewing our boardroom tracks. I hope you like them.
Yeah, and spread the word. Let people know about what's available. You know, you can go back and look at past ones. I think we've done like 27 or more.
I don't know how many we've done already.
Quite a bit.
It's a blessing. And we need to repeat some, too, because, you know, it's kind of like a...
Oh, but there's much more.
I know there's so much more, but they do like 26 shows. And then
they rerun
them, and people like the reruns, but they did
they're
the first
all over
time.
Facebook. In fact, please remember to subscribe. Maybe you're just viewing
subscribe
this, but
what?
We want you to subscribe to YouTube.
Yeah, do that. Does
if
it cost anything to subscribe?
I think you can watch this as well on Facebook, but
they don't cost nothing?
No.
Oh,
I need to show you some things.
You got to show me something.
So but not just subscribe. You need to hit the notification bell so that whenever these things are posted, and generally the chats are posted on a Thursday.
So you're speaking in tongues to me right there, notification
just
bell.
Just listen.
You make me say that, and I don't even know what
it is. I'm giving you some new thoughts
I'm being led. I'm being led.
We're a team.
Yeah. So subscribe to YouTube and hit the notification bell. Okay? Or you can watch on Facebook, or you can watch it at jdm.org. Hey, would you like some wonderful messages that'll keep you going? It won't cost you nothing. TotalJDM.org. Because of our faithful financial partner, we used to charge for that because it cost money to do it.
It was a subscription monthly fee.
Yeah, had to. It was another charge. Yeah. Not no more.
Hundreds
you know why?
Of powerful messages available.
My partners. And Kathy came to me and said, partners are doing good. And I think, and I said,
well actually,
let's just give it a
we
give it
switched
free.
It all whenever the whole COVID thing back in March because we wanted to get as much word out there because we knew that's what people needed to feed their spirit, to overcome the spirit of fear that was trying to attack people, to, you know, and also the messages we have on there about healing.
Our partners have
important.
The same spirit that me and Kathy have, the givers. So they give, and we're able to put out over 400 messages of her and mine free. Watch all you want. And you'll be blessed.
And you know what, Jesse? Cool. People are binging. You don't even know what that is, do you?
Oh, I used to binge on booze before I was saved. I know what binging is.
Binging
that I know about.
Yeah, but they're binging on the Word of God, and they're getting stronger and filled with the Word of God, and it's...
You mean they're getting drunk on the Word? Is that what you said?
They've been drinking. but not the Bible.
Drinking like this. Praise God, what a blessing.
And because of that, they are invincible. The Word of God makes us powerful in Him. There's nothing impossible when we put God's Word to work and we believe Him.
Okay. We want to let's deal with that armor of God next.
And
we'll have some insights that you maybe hadn't heard before, and it'll be a blessing.
God will give it to us.
Yes, He will. Until next time, bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Because what you think is what you become.
Amen.
See you next day. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
God bless.